Well, good afternoon again. Welcome. What a great turnout. Thank you all for coming to today's events. For those of you who don't know who I am, I'm Jim Yeager. I'm a professor in the Department of Environmental Health and Engineering, and I'm the interim director of the Center for a Livable Future. The event or conversation that's about to take place is one of two events we're holding at the school over the next 2 days to launch the CLF's 20th anniversary. Since 1996, the CLF has been addressing some of the most pressing issues in food systems while advancing public health and protecting the environment. Today, on behalf of all of the CLF staff and its fellows, I'm proud to say that the Center for a Livable Future is at the forefront of the food movement. It is educating our future leaders on issues of food and human health and providing and communicating critical research to shape our country's food system for generations, hopefully for generations to come. Now, a few housekeeping details. We're live streaming this event today, and a recording will be posted on the CLF website. We're planning a short question and answer session at the end of the conversation, and we'll have microphones on both sides of the hall. Since we're live streaming and recording, please wait for microphone to keep your questions brief. The Twitter hashtag CLF event has been set up to tweet about today's event and to text questions and comments for Mr. Berry and Mr. Schlosser. After the talk, there will be a reception in the gallery out to the left as you exit this hall. So now I'd like to turn the program over to Bob Martin, who is the director of the CLF's Food Policy Program, and will introduce today's speakers.
Thank you, Jim. I too would like to welcome everyone here and those who are viewing online. As Jim said, we are streaming, and so I would ask, in addition to his comments, that people silence their cell phones if you have not already. I would also like to make a couple of acknowledgments before I get started on the introductions. First, I was a history minor in college as an undergraduate, and I'd like to note that today is the 75th anniversary of the attack on Pearl Harbor. And the attack on Pearl Harbor drew the United States into World War II, and it really forever changed the United States and our role in the world. I'd also like to acknowledge Tanya Berry, who's Wendell's spouse of nearly 60 years. She's here today with us, and we're very happy to have her. And also, I believe their daughter Mary Berry is watching online. She is the director of the Berry Center in Kentucky and had planned to be here with us today, but has fallen ill. It's a minor thing, but she was regretted that she couldn't be here. So Mary, I hope you are watching. I'd also like to acknowledge really just about everybody at the Center for a Livable Future who worked to make this event possible. And I would specifically like to acknowledge the Center's events team and the Center's Associate Director, Sean McKenzie, and and Alicia Carter, the Center's events coordinator. The advancement of public interest issues many times can be tracked through highly original moments influencing the course and future of those issues. Those seminal moments can be books, publications, movies, and as I'm afraid we've seen recently, an election that helped mark the interest and progress on these issues. On food issues and the recognition of the part they play in our health and environment, those seminal moments include several published works, including The Jungle in 1906 by Upton Sinclair, The Unsettling of America in 1977 by Wendell Berry, Fast Food Nation in 2001 by Eric Schlosser, Food Politics in 2003 by Marion Nestle, and The Omnivore's Dilemma in 2006 by Michael Pollan. Nowadays, books and documentaries dealing with food issues, how it is produced, and the impact on people are fairly common. It is interesting for me to see that there was 70-year spans between some of those early works, and now it's a shorter span of a couple of years between the later works, and now it's a common thing. So it is my honor today to introduce the program, The World Ending Fire, A Conversation with Wendell Berry. It brings together two of the people who have significantly influenced the direction and advancement of food and agricultural reform through their work. They both approach their work, in my experience, thoughtfully, eloquently, with integrity and humility. Eric Schlosser is an investigative journalist and the author of several New York Times bestsellers, including Fast Food Nation, Reefer Madness, Chew on This, a children's book co-authored with Charles Wilson, and most recently, Command and Control, a stark look at the mismanagement of America's nuclear weapons. He was a co-producer of the documentary Food, Inc., as well as the producer for Command and Control, a documentary based on his latest book. If any person that I've ever met doesn't really need an introduction, it's Wendell Berry, but I'm going to do one anyway. Wendell Berry is a poet, essayist, novelist, environmental activist, cultural critic, and most importantly to me, a farmer. He has authored more than 25 books of poetry, 16 volumes of essays, and numerous novels and short story collections. I could spend the rest of our allotted time listing all of the awards he's received, but let me mention just three. He was awarded the National Humanities Medal by President Obama in 2010. He was named the 41st Jefferson Lecturer in the Humanities in 2012, and he was named a Fellow in the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2013 in recognition of his life's work. Please join me in welcoming Wendell Berry and Eric Schlosser.
Well, thank you all for coming. And I want to start out, Mr. Berry, by saying it's a great privilege to be seated beside not only one of America's great thinkers, but someone whom I believe to be America's greatest living writer. And there's a fair amount of competition for that. So maybe we should start out by trying to explain the title of your upcoming collection of essays that's going to be published in the United Kingdom. And the title is also the title of our conversation today, The World-Ending Fire. And I believe it's from an essay of yours that has the comment connecting the world-ending fire to industrial fundamentalism. And what does that mean, industrial fundamentalism?
Well, I want to comment first that you really fixed me introducing me that way.
Well,
I can't live up to that.
Well, you already have. And I believe it, and I'm privileged to be able to say it to you.
You're just setting these people up for a terrible disappointment.
Hold on. I didn't say you were a good talker. I said you were our greatest writer.
All right.
Okay.
Well, all right.
So, industrial fundamentalism.
Industrial fundamentalism seems to me to be a kind of faith that industry can do whatever needs to be done by its own standards. And that if it doesn't know how to do it now, it soon will, because science and industry are coming right along.
And in The World-Ending Fire, which is a very powerful image, is it meant literally? Is it meant, because certainly during the Cold War, there was this horror of the nuclear apocalypse, and you could argue that nuclear weapons are the ultimate technology that could lead to that, or is it really just a symbol, a biblical symbol of where this mentality leads?
I don't think it's exactly simply an allusion to the Bible, and it isn't simply a symbol. We've been burning the world up, literally, from the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. I mean, coal is the earth. Petroleum is the earth. So if you want to be desperate about it, you could say, well, the world-ending fire is burning in every internal combustion engine every day. Mm. And Fire is, of course, not the best thing to let loose, and we've pretty much let it loose. It does escape these, and has its effect. There is such a thing as external combustion, too, and that's combustion out of control, and you've dealt with, well, it isn't combustion, is it, nuclear power, but it's fire.
Well, there were the fires in Tennessee not so long ago that were probably connected to that internal combustion, ultimately.
Yeah, and people in places that are poor and upset set a lot of fires, which is an interesting thing and needs to be asked about and understood. I don't understand it, but they do light a paper sack and throw it out of a car window sometimes, up in eastern Kentucky, too. Wes Jackson has quit talking about it lately. He says some things that I never quit thinking about, and he quits. But several years ago, Wes was talking about how you could tell the health of an operation by taking its temperature. And so he said, well, we went from the sun, the heat of the sun as it affects us, to wood fires, coal fires, petroleum fires, to nuclear. What do you say? What's the right word? You can't say nuclear fire. You say nuclear heat.
Yeah.
That I like that. I like to think about that. How can we reduce the temperature of our lives? We're running a very high temperature, it seems to me, at the moment, and in internal and external combustion, and we're too ready to do that. We're too comfortable with it. We take it too much for granted. And I'm speaking now as a person totally dependent on an old pickup truck. That is not petroleum efficient.
Now, your work has had a great influence on me, and I'm sure there are so many people in this room who've been influenced by it. And I'm wondering, because so much of your thinking goes against the grain and challenges mainstream opinion, when you were at university and when you were starting out as a writer, what writers influenced you, not just your writing style, but your worldview and your view of what America could be?
Well, in my education, once I got to college, of course, I was under the influence of the great moderns, Pound and Eliot and those people, Hemingway, Faulkner. And I should say that what I was, I think, most under the influence of was the assumption that I had come from a place that you couldn't amount to much in, and that the last thing I ought to do would be to go back to it. And that was implicit in my education, that people coming from such a place as I came from would go up in the world and amount to something and be somebody and go someplace, and that language, you know. And I assumed that that was the way it was for a long time, for much too long. I subscribed to that, and I thought that I would be a kind of an academic wanderer, maybe, that I would go from job to job and support my writing by teaching school and whatnot. And then Tanya and I got a job offer in Kentucky to teach at the University of Kentucky. And Tanya and I were living in New York at that time, and I was teaching at NYU, and we took the job offer. And people looking back at that now say that we were very wise people to do that and forward-looking and so on, and there was nothing to that. We did it because we wanted to. We did it because we wanted to. I wasn't happy away from home, and I needed livestock. And Tanya will tell you that she thought I needed to be at home. Now, she didn't tell me that, but she she didn't want me to go home by myself. But she made it possible, and so we did. We went home. And that changed everything. And then I began to have a real need for some writers. And what I needed were the writers who came from a place like I did, a place such as mine, and had been able to make something of it and make imagination live in that place. And so I was looking at writers like Jane Austen and Thomas Hardy to start in England, and then William Faulkner, William Carlos Williams, Sarah Orne Jewett up in Maine. They began to give me something I really needed, which simply was the confidence that somebody could come from Port Royal, Kentucky and do good work there.
And Wallace Stegner, who was a teacher of yours, and I think one of the great American novelists of the 20th century, but was often dismissed in New York as a regional writer.
Yes.
And that's because he wrote about the American West that he knew intimately, and I'm wondering what sort of influence he might have had, because there were an extraordinary group of writers who studied under him at Stanford.
The New York Times said he was the dean of Western writers and called him William. But anyway, in that time in my life when I supposed I was going to do like everybody else and wander about, I thought Wallace Stegner was a good writer and a writing teacher. But when I went home, then it, you see how that changed my perspective and my outlook and my need. All of a sudden, Wallace Stegner appeared to me not only as a writer and a Western writer, but moreover a writer who had taken responsibility for his region and tried to do what he could to help it and take care of it. And so he, probably at a certain time in his life, had needed John Wesley Powell as much as I needed Wallace Stegner to put him on that subject of aridity and the need of Western people to acknowledge the aridity of the Western region. And so then I began to think of Wallace Stegner, read him, and talk to him in a different way.
Another writer I just want to throw out to you, who was also a student of Stegner's and became a passionate defender of the land, and I know that you agreed with him on some things and disagreed on others, was Edward Abbey.
Edward Abbey was a fellow at Stanford the year before I was. And I think that I was also in very much need of somebody who understood me. And when I read Edward Abbey's little novel, I never met him face to face in our lives.
You never met him?
Never met him. But when I read that little novel, Fire on the Mountain, I think then I wrote to him, and we exchanged little cards and letters back and forth. That novel is about an old rancher in the land that out there in New Mexico that was taken over for the atomic experiment.
Alamogordo.
And the old man won't give up his ranch. And finally, the old the old man has taken his stand and he won't give up. He thinks his holding of that ranch is more important than the United States of America. Mm-hmm. Finally, one day, an officer from the Air Force comes to him and says, good news, sir, we're going to let you stay. And the old rancher says to him, you're not going to let me do anything. And I cried. Mm. That really hit me. And he understood, you see, that. I understood it perfectly. And so we wrote back and forth to each other. I think the only thing we ever probably disagreed about, and it was about to happen, and I don't remember to what extent it did happen. At the end of his life, I think we were about to disagree about population control. I remember writing a letter saying, Ed Abbey thinks I'm a Catholic. I wasn't a Catholic. I was just kind of ouchy about the idea of saying there are too many people because I was afraid of the person who would come and say, these are the ones that are too many.
Yeah.
Let's get on with it. So I don't know how we were going to come out on that because Abby was on a trip to the East Coast and he was going to come see me on the way home and he didn't. Mm. And it was because he was sick, I think. Mm.
Well, I think he had an equal love of nature, but maybe a darker view of people than it seems in your work.
Well, maybe so, but there were people that he genuinely loved out of his heart, characters in his books. Mm. I think Bonnie Abzug and... Hey Duke,
yeah.
And Dr. Sarvis, and seldom seen Smith, Abby loved with a very free-hearted, really simple-hearted kind of affection.
So you study...
He loved some old ranchers, too.
Yeah.
And he enjoyed provoking them. Cowboys, you know.
Yeah. So you study literature, and it brings you back to Kentucky. And how, then, do you evolve... beyond literature as a focus, and begin to immerse yourself in economics and politics and bigger social issues? And how much of an influence was your father, who had been a supporter of the New Deal and that whole belief in the common man?
My dad was behind me, of course, and I knew what he stood for, though I hadn't studied it out with the care that he deserved, of course, being his son. One of my great wishes is that I had been the same age as my father and could have been his friend. Mm. But anyway, I had him and his teaching. He taught all the time. Except when he was demanding, and then it was a different order of business. But anyway, my dad said, for instance, if you want people to love their country, let them own a piece of it. And he held to that idea. And he was very much involved in the creation of the tobacco program under the New Deal. And our specific branch of that was the Burley Tobacco Growers Cooperative Association. And one of the things that was remarkable about that program was that it included every farmer who wanted to be included, no matter how small. Mm. And they even had a minimum acreage that they would not go below. Mm-hmm. I think it was an acre. Mm-hmm. And that was the way my father thought. And he had... in mind, when he wanted to know what he was working for, a few young farmers in his day, I knew them finally as old farmers and now departed farmers, but he had an idea of what a decent life was like and what ought to be done to support it. And he gave his whole heart to that because he'd seen his father and his father's generation, the suffering that they went through. There was an economic suffering. And so I had that. And when Tanya and I came home from New York in 1964, I'd been walking to work from my subway stop through an old neighborhood shopping center in New York, and it was in bad shape. Mm. The chain stores were putting the pressure on it, and so that situation in which people dealt with people they knew day after day, the grocer and the butcher and the baker and so on, saw their old customers day after day. That's implicit in that, of course, is quality control and honesty and the other things that we now try to do with bureaucracy. But anyway, when we got home, the country towns were in the same shape and for the same reasons. And so very quickly after I got there, I could see that everything I loved and honored about my home place was in danger and was in decline. And then I saw in 1965, my friend, the writer Gurney Norman, took me to see strip mining, contour stripping. And the first time I stood and watched a bulldozer go in to open that cut in the mountainside, just throwing everything over top of the coal down the hill, I was my father's son, and I was shocked completely. It just seemed unspeakable. It never had occurred to me that people could do a thing like that. Well, then you see I was on the way, and I began to write essays in protection of local life, rural life, the life of the land. And I realized very soon, from some of the instruction I got from the people in eastern Kentucky who were fighting the coal miners, the coal companies, it was a great mistake to separate the land and the people. If you do, that just makes a lot of trouble. It permits the people to think of the land as an inert material quantity that can be safely exploited without upsetting, ultimately, the people.
One of the remarkable and I think unique things about our host, the Center for a Livable Future, is that it combines the study of food production with public health and the environment. And it seems to me that you began with a sort of a specialized knowledge of literature, and then in your life and your work broke through that narrow boundary and started looking at things in a more holistic way, which seems really essential and contrary not only to academia and what that usually demands, but also to contrary to politics in America, which tends to be single issue, which tends to, you're an environmentalist or you're an animal rights person or there's one cause after another.
Yes.
And again, I'm wondering how you began personally to break through a narrow focus and start to have a more grand, holistic view of what was happening in this country.
You can't start from a little community as I do and then become a specialist in problems, because the little community focuses and suffers from all those problems. So to try to single out one thing you'd go to work on is just impossible. I couldn't do that. I can't think about climate change and look away from the ruining land and the ruining communities and the ruining towns and the ruining lives that are around me. All that has to do with climate change. A lot of climate change starts right there. Mm-hmm. But I'm not going to do it. And another thing, you use that word holistic, and my dad used to use a metaphor. If you'd had a gully or a gall on your farm that was naked and ruining, and you healed it up and you got the grass growing on it again, My dad would say, well, you've got it haired over. Haired. Now you see, what he was, the metaphor was the comparison of the gall on the land to a harness gall on a mule or a horse, a saddle gall. And you see, there are lots of implication in that. The land is a living thing that ought not to be hurt. A living thing. How conscious it is an interesting question.
And when did you encounter the work of Sir Albert Howard, who was really in the 1930s starting to look at the land and the people on the land and the livestock on the land as a total world and not focusing on one?
I had a very good editor. I had gotten an agent, which I didn't have for very long, but she got me a contract with Harcourt Brace, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich, it was at that time. Dan Wickenden was my editor. He was a very bright man, and he knew that we'd moved back to the country, and he was a gardener. He was the son of a gardener named Leonard Wickenden, who wrote a book called Natural. I don't remember the name of the book now. Anyway, the book was all about composting and raising a garden and having a hen flock to get the manure that you needed. And so on. It was a kind of a whole systems garden book. And so I got hold of that. And then I said to Dan, what started your dad on this? Well, he said, I think Sir Albert Howard. So I found then Sir Albert Howard. And it was all plain to me. I didn't have to be convinced by Albert Howard any more than I had by Leonard Wickenden. And Howard was simply saying, as people before him had said, and as, for instance, well, John Todd afterward, the New Alchemy Institute, and preeminently Wes Jackson, if you're going to farm, and you're going to do it without destroying your farm, you've got to imitate nature's, what Albert Howard called nature's farming. And so Wes, who had not read Howard, began by saying, if you want to know what's wrong with these Kansas wheat fields, put a wheat field, so to speak, right beside a native prairie and study the difference. And because a lot of thinking can come out of that. Howard was saying, if you want to know how to farm, look at the woods. But he has a wonderful paragraph. I can't quite quote it, but he says, when nature farms, this is the way she does. She never farms without livestock. She grows mixed crops, a lot of diversity. She maintains great reserves of fertility. She wastes nothing, and so on. So there it was, and I haven't departed from it a bit. That's what we've got to do. We've got to study nature and understand that she is a very beneficent and bountiful mother, but she's not a very forgiving one. And she has punishments. And some of our suffering now, she's imposing on us. And it would be a good idea to ask about which ones of our sufferings she is imposing on us.
I guess one of your essays that very succinctly describes the opposite of what you've just said about nature is the culture that's arisen in America, and I think the title's called Total Economy. And is that a concept that you can maybe explain? What is the total economy?
Well, the total economy is an economy in which you're dependent on suppliers for everything you have. And American agriculture, as it has got to be at its most expensive and extensive, is corn, soybean agriculture of the Midwest, in which the farmer's economy is totally consists of buying and selling. Mm-hmm. And so the exposure to the economy as it now is, as exploitive as it now is, the exposure is total. The farmer, he or she, has nothing to fall back on. Nothing. They have nothing that they can do for themselves. Mm. And moreover, very little that they're taken free from nature. Mm-hmm. A great sheep breeder in Kentucky, Henry Bassoon, used to say, it's wonderful to have nature working for you. She works at a minimum wage. If you work against her, she charges.
Mm-hmm. And part of that, I think, is also the loss of freedom to this new corporate colonialism and how that economy leads to a kind of a centrally controlled group of, central control by a group of corporations, not by the state, that just makes people and consumers and farmers dependent on them.
What they had to fall back on was subsistence. Mm-hmm. If you have land under your feet, which has been an important thing to humans, land under your feet that you can use, even if you're a tenant farmer, even if you're a slave and you got land under your feet that you can use, you have a little something on your side, something mm-hmm. that is in your favor. So some of my thinking begins with something that used to be said to me over and over again. When I was a kid, farmers would say, usually as somewhere in the presence of their garden, they may run me out, but they'll never starve me out. Hmm. And farmers were talked out of that. Hmm. There were experts, very highly credentialed experts, who could tell them, you can't afford to grow a garden anymore. And so we've got this very curious thing of dairy people sending their milk to town and buying it back in boxes, sending their cattle, buying it back over the counter at Kroger's. Well, you don't buy over the counter at Kroger's anymore, do you? Anyway, they get it out of the cooler. Mm-hmm. And this is insane. Mm-hmm. So the question is, how can people take back these things that they can actually do for themselves? Do for themselves. That has an economic value and an economic worth, and it underwrites a kind of dignity that people had better not be caught without.
Hmm. It seems to me that this worldview of yours is pretty strongly established by the 1970s, the critique of technology, the critique of the way the economy is increasingly being controlled, the critique of how nature is being misused. And in the four decades since then, again, without embarrassing you, I think you've had a profound impact on the thinking of many others, and we can point to groups in society who are taking these ideas and trying to change things. But as we sit here in December of 2016, how are you feeling about recent events and what has just happened? It's remarkable that rural America has just spoken in a way that on the surface seems to contradict so many of these values, but may underneath that be crying for attention to what is being destroyed and what is being lost. I'm curious about your thoughts about where we are right now and maybe I'm looking for some hope that this is just a moment, and that this is not the beginning truly of the world-ending fire.
Well, I don't. I think I told you I wasn't surprised, because I think it's the conditions for this election and the Trump triumph have been building up in rural America ever since VJ Day, 1945. There. These people out there in the country who've been dismissed as dispensable, unneeded, redundant or something, and the economy has told them that there's no need for them. And so a certain resentment has understandably built up. Personal response to the election, among others, is, well, I'm still on the losing side. And that's where I've taken up my residence. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be on the losing side. I'm not going to live a day on the winning side. And, you know, maybe that even the youngest people here may wind up on the losing side for a long, long time. So there's that. If Hillary Clinton had won, I would still be on the losing side, and I would just have to go to work. Now, about hope, I got asked about hope at another school, Center College in Kentucky, the other night. And I said what I believe is true, that I can't give anybody hope. Hope has to come up out of you. And it's been a struggle for me to be hopeful. And all I can do is invite other people to take up the same struggle, which is largely to find the reasons, to find something worth hoping for. Is a very good place to start. And there are things worth hoping for. There are good people. This is still, as badly as we've used it, a very beautiful world. And all these things are part of the resource for somebody who's looking for hope. But hope is a virtue, you know. It's a virtue. You have to have it. You have to choose it. It's not as if it was popped into your brain by some gene like a computer chip before you were born. I think you have to work for it all the time. Now, there are times when I'm pretty down and pretty much in need of hope. And that just puts me in the same slot with everybody else. But I think we've been talked out of a lot of things we need by the materialists, the scientific authorities, who are willing to take something like love or reverence or loving kindness or forgiveness, mercy, and say, well, that's either genetic and reducible to physics, or it doesn't mean anything because you can't weigh, measure, or isolate it and examine it. I think we've just got to take those things back. Hmm. We've just got to say they belong to us. You don't have any right to take those things away. And happiness is a great mental faculty. It happens. One of the best things I know about happiness is that some days I'm happy. Hmm. I'm happy. I didn't try to be happy. I don't have anything in particular to be happy about or happier than it was yesterday, but I'm happy. And, you know, I read that French novelist, Jean Genet. I read in a little book about him that he said in 1954, I've been happy for the last 30 or 40 years. Well, you know what happened in the 30 or 40 years before 1954. I just love him for that. That just tickled me. That just turned me upside down when I read that. Well, what a great thing that is. How it undermines. Suppose you're just freely happy for 5 minutes. That just destroys everybody who's tried to sell you something to make you happy. How subversive. It's possible. Let me tell you, young people, it's possible sometimes to go for a whole day and be happy and not buy a thing.
I think that's the most un-American thing you've said today.
Well, we have all these people telling us that what we've got is not any good. Our house, our wife, our husband, our car, whatever it is not as good as a person of our stature and standing ought to have. And we ought to be very unhappy because we don't have it. Or we're not better looking. You know, what a genius it was who discovered that you can tell some women you're not quite attractive and they'll buy anything. Well, that's something else. You know, that's strength if you can resist that. A dear friend of mine, and he wasn't educated. He was one of my great teachers. He went to school perhaps unwillingly. He liked going and coming. He went as far as the eighth grade, I think. But he told me, about like this, this is pretty much exactly what he said. Something better, something better. Everybody's talking about something better. The important thing is to feel good and be proud of what you got. Don't make no difference if it ain't nothing but a log pen. Isn't that wonderful? He was a healthy man. He really was a great man.
And one of the things you've written about on this subject is the tendency to focus on movements and narrow movements and the outer manifestations of the problem, as opposed to looking in the mirror and thinking about the ways that you can make the change in yourself as a first step to seeing the change in the world.
Well, that's humbling enough, and a good exercise for sure. But then look around you at your town or your block in the city or and see what it's coming to. That really needs to be done. And that's, you see, that despecializes this conservation effort. I want to tell you, I think that the climate change issue is a big distraction. I'm not denying it. It seems to me to be completely likely if you put all this junk in the air that it would have bad effects. And climate change seems like a reasonable possibility to me. But you mustn't look away from the other things that are wrong. And I think that what we've got to have is a broad-fronted movement, and it would be economic, to protect everything that's worth protecting, to stop permanent damage to everything that's worth keeping. Just that broad, and it's got to be economic. You've got to get in it on the basis of daily life and how we live and what we're spending to live and what it's costing us. That all has to be reckoned with. This is not something that I think can be enacted very soon, but that's what I'm for. And I told somebody that has to be a whole program of that kind has to be carried on by whole people, people who are not shamed to say that they love something or that they have reverence or that they should not ashamed of what I call the upper branches of our language that have words in them like honesty and fidelity and those intangibles. So those supposed intangibles that nevertheless have a very tangible effect.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've spoken about being on the losing side, and even if Hillary had won, you would be on the losing side. And yet, not that long ago, you were part of a sit-in at the governor's office and Kentucky, yeah, protesting against mountaintop removal and the desecration of nature. So I guess before opening it up to questions from the audience, I'm curious about what is it in you that feels on the losing side but just continues the fight?
Well, I don't want to quit. Well, I said to my brother one time, I said, do you ever think, and does it ever get on you, your nerves, that we're going to spend the rest of our lives fighting? He said, oh, I don't know. Well, that sit-in at the governor's office, as I remember, began, I made a speech in which I had said I had considered the possibility that conservationists applying for grants to buy politicians. Well, I enjoyed that.
Yeah.
But when you get right down to it, you know, probably you couldn't get a grant that could outbid the coal industries. So I made a speech up at the Capitol, and I said, you know, if anybody was ready to step over the line, I was ready to do it too. And a bunch of us did, and we went to Frankfurt, and we told the governor we had certain demands, and he would have to meet them, or we were going to stay. And he played a very clever, but wasn't really, maybe it was a trick. He invited us to stay. It was the weekend was coming up, and so we just did. We stayed in his reception room, a whole bunch of us. I want you to understand, the score between the conservationists and the coal industry is 100-0. Mm. We've been totally defeated. Mm. We haven't got a chance. But that was one of the best weekends I ever spent in my life. We had the happiest time, and people sent us food and bedding, and some people even came in and gave us a massage. So I think that's the way you get on, you know. You're up against it. You're hard up against it. You do what you can. And you have a good time. You love your allies, the people you're doing it with. It was a great love in that governor's office, more than has been in it in all its And the funny thing was, a bunch of us went back up there one day for a reason, and the doors were opening all over the place except the governors. They were all glad to see us. The security people and so on, oh, welcome back, glad to see you. It was very good. And so, you know, there it was, a little goodness opened up, a little goodness. Just keep it, maybe there'll be a chance to stick a wedge in there, you know, and do a little more good sometime. Who knows? Who knows?
And so that was the spirit of the civil disobedience that you did.
That was the spirit of it.
And that spirit carried on to some of the people.
Oh, it's
you
still there.
Expect.
I think among people, some of those people, I'll always love some of those people. Hmm. We told stories, told jokes. One of the men, I see that.
Okay.
one of the men was an ex-coal miner. Stanley Sturgill had learned an aria when he was in school from some opera. I don't know which one it was. So he could be in the state music contest. And one evening while we were in the Capitol, we all went out in the rotunda and Stanley sang his aria. And then he sang How Great Thou Art. And everybody was very moved, you know, and very happy with Stanley and pleased, proud of him.
And had you been involved in civil disobedience before that?
Yes, a couple of times. I've had an easy time of it as a civil disobeyer. I went with Bill McKibben on that first trip, his first trip to Washington, and the police, I think, just decided there was too many of us to book, and they let us off. And then before that, I stepped over the property boundary with some other people at Marble Hill, a nuclear power plant that they were trying to build between Madison, Indiana, and Louisville. And I got arrested, but it didn't, I guess I got booked then, but it didn't go to jail and it never did get tried, so it's nothing to brag about. It's been fun all the way.
Well, before we turn it over now to questions from the audience, I would suggest there's probably never going to be a greater time to be arrested in the years to come and more opportunities for being arrested, so.
Well, I just think that that's probably necessary at times, and demonstrating is necessary, and I've done that. But it's not the answer. There's a limit to what you can accomplish that way. Anybody thinks you're going to solve problems in the street, you can't keep your people in the street long enough, for one thing. But you can't have a discourse in the street either.
Mm-hmm. So maybe people who have questions, there's a microphone right there.
Okay, now. Thanks, Kellogg Schwab. I'm a professor here in the Department of Bible Health Engineering. Great, thank you. Really, actually, inspiring and truly, I think, hope and the things you described are what we need to rally around. My question to you is, a few blocks from here, we have urban kind of deserts, challenges that we face here in our urban society as well. What would you recommend as a farmer? As someone who has this true understanding of where things come from the earth, to those of us that are in urban environments that sometimes have these challenges of having that sense of ownership of land but still need to have that rallying point, how can we learn from you? How can we learn from those wise teachers that stepped out of the eighth grade but still had that true salt of an understanding of what's going on? And what would you recommend that we share to others about this?
This business of giving advice is very dangerous. I don't give advice to people unless I'm very sure I'll never see them again. All I can tell you is that country people are dependent on city people, and vice versa. There's no urban problem that doesn't involve the country, and no problem in the country that doesn't involve city people. And we're defining each other's fate all the time. And I can't tell you what to do if there's an urban desert near you. Learn all about it. I would do that, I guess. See what can be done about it. But it's possible to make a decent life in the city. That choice of a decent or an indecent life is everywhere. But people can't have that unless they help each other to have it. And I've always thought that people anywhere, if they ask, or maybe already know what they can do for each other, can do things for each other. And this is free. If you think about trading, bartering, that's a good thing to do, you know, because it doesn't get on the books. Nobody knows anything about it. cultivate the secret life that nobody can find out anything about. Make these alliances with your neighbors. You know, people are going to think, well, that guy's alliance with his neighbor is not worth looking into. But 10,000 of them can take place here. And then they begin to be worth something. And a great thing is happening. And it's decentralized. There's nobody can be pointed out as the cause. Well, that's just really wonderful. So, what you can do without equipment, for a start, you can get to know somebody without any equipment. I like that. I like to think of that. You can get to, without paying any money, you can get to know somebody. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Berry. When you were talking about 20 minutes ago about virtues such as honesty and sharing and community, and you said, we can't just leave that to, and you paused, I imagined you would say, we can't just leave that to organized religion. And of course, my heart leapt when I thought you were going to say that, even though I'm involved in organized religion. Could you talk a bit about the basis for the ethical and moral stance that you have taken in your life that's meant so much to you, the source of that for you?
Oh, well, if you're in organized religion, I can tell you that that we read the same books, maybe. I look in the Bible quite a lot, and some of it is very comforting, some of it is very difficult, very challenging, some of it I don't like, I'll tell you, but you know, there's some good stuff in there. I've been reading the Gospels again in the late at night when I wake up. I have to do something to keep my mind from running, and so I do that, and that's very moving to me. It's very moving. I was just reading about John the Baptist's advice to the soldiers. Don't do any violence. Be satisfied with your pay. What else did he tell them? You remember? Two or three things. Really very good common sense that he spoke. But then, you know, those. If you go to the Gospels, all this is taking place under the thumb of Rome. All those are written from the losing side. So, and they're still on the losing side, I'd say. My own impression is. But I woke up one night and I was kind of depressed, worrying. Which is a bad thing. My favorite text lately has been, take no thought for the morrow. This is not exactly the place to say that, but but it's really good advice. Sufficient unto the day are the evils thereof. I've been saying that to myself over and over again. You can put anything you want to in the future. A better time or a worse time, or good things, bad things. And we're really in an epidemic now of being afraid of the future. There's a great epidemic now of fear. And besides, fear in the future doesn't have, there's no basis for it really yet. And it's the worst motive in the world. One thing I dislike about the climate movement is that it's almost exclusive appeal to guilt, anger, and fear. I just don't think that's going to, the answer is going to come from there. I think it'll come from love. I think it'll come from people finding work that they love and loving one another. And that requires a certain hypocrisy, you know. I'm a big advocate for hypocrisy. If you don't actually love your neighbor, then it's a good idea to be able to pretend like you do. So, and I'm saying there's another thing besides contingency planning, and that's provision. Provision is planting your garden. Provision is doing the responsible thing when you ought to do it, right then. And fear, I'm just not recommending it. Don't be afraid. Fear not. That's what, you know, that's what Martini said to his wife as they were carrying him off for the surgery when he died. He said to her in Latin, "Fear not." That's what the angel said to the shepherds. "Fear not." Good advice.
Thank you so much.
Hi. You've talked about the current economy in which...
Which economy?
This economy that we're in right now, in which industry is making people dependent on them. And I think what you just described a little bit earlier was an alternate economy in which people can really rely on each other and get to know their neighbors and barter and trade and kind of take back some ownership. And I'm wondering if you could describe a little bit about what you think it would take to move from this economy that we have now to that other economy that you just described.
I don't know. I'm all for the movement. But if I knew, I'd be a dangerous person. You see, I think what we have to do is be very careful to understand the kind of economy we're for and the kind of economic behavior we're willing to practice and be for. Now, my problem is that I'm an agrarian through and through. I think I have a long tradition, thousands of years behind that. And there isn't an agrarian party. They're just a, but I think that the people who are worrying about the way we're using the land are a scattering of agrarians. They're not liberals and conservatives. But bad off is that puts me, I think it's worth continuing to talk about what's desirable. And from the agrarians, we get certain values. The value of nature, the value of the land, it all starts there. The value of having a little piece of it that's usable by you. The necessity to be thrifty, the necessity to be careful. Well, you see my drift. Humble. These are very humble things, and they need to live in an age of sensation and large catastrophic events.
This is an appropriate question from our social media channels. If young people want to know how to live a good and satisfying life, what do they prioritize?
What do they?
If young people want to know how to live a good and satisfying life, what should they prioritize?
Don't prioritize anything. One thing alone is not enough. I've been thinking about this book list, this desert island book list. If you had 10 books, which ones would you pick? Or 100? Or 1,000? All I can tell you is that if you picked them, and the next thing you would need would be another one. So don't prioritize things. If I were a young person now, and I were trying to have a meaningful life, I would try to look beyond job creation. I would try to look beyond the idea of the career. A lot of young people are visiting at home now, and Tanya says they're all coming because they want a life instead of a career. But you see, when you start talking about job creation, you're destroying the idea of vocation. And vocation is what you're called to do. There are various ways to put that. You can say that that's what God puts you in the world to do. You're finding out what God puts you here to do. Or you can say, this thing is what my gifts have enabled me to do, require me to do. I have these gifts, and I have to take some kind of responsibility for using them, for giving them. So there's not a list. There's not a list, and I don't think things should be prioritized in that way. Now, in the spur of the moment, you know, if your livestock's in the road, that assumes a kind of priority.
And on that note, thank you all very much.
Thank you.